Well, last week, again, I asked that question. And this week, what we're talking about is, are you willing to open your mouth to God? We need to be able to communicate in our relationship with Him. He wants to hear from you. It's not just that He knows what's going on. He wants to hear from you. And so a lot of times, you know, my wife isn't in the room right now, but sometimes this is what I can look like when I come home from work, all right? And this is not every day, and this is something I've gotten better at. But sometimes it looks like this, where I come over, I come in the door, right? I don't knock. I have a key to my own house. I come in the door. I walk in. She's coming here looking at me. I come in the door, and she starts asking questions to me. She wants to know about my day. But immediately what I do, because, you know, work is hard, right? You know, so I come home, and I just find myself down to my favorite spot on the couch, and I sit down, and I pull out this amazing, terrible machine. And she starts wanting to hear from me, asking me questions, and I'm just sitting here. I'm just like, yeah, yeah, you know. Well, tell me about your day, she asked me. I'm just like, yeah, it was good. It was good. Well, and this is what sometimes we look like in our relationship with God. We have so many different things going on in our life, and we're struggling, or we're having amazing situations, and yet we just walk through life sitting on a couch on our cell phone, metaphorically speaking. We just go through life and we don't open our mouths to actually communicate with the one who has saved us from our sin, who has set us free. We just go through life, forgetting the very relationship who has given us life in the first place. And so this morning we're talking about praying. We're talking about prayer. And again, in that reference of making sure that we're listening, because prayer is communication with God, not communication to God. So when you're praying, you need to make sure you're willing to hear and listen and that wait for that response. If you pray, say amen, and then walk away, you may be missing your answer because you're not willing to wait for it. Sometimes you say amen, you walk away in faith because that's what, you know, that's what it is, and you're good. You know it, and you move. But sometimes when you pray, you need to wait and listen. Well, this morning we're going to be talking about prayer in a whole bunch of different ways. We're talking about putting God first and allowing Him to be the one who comforts and transforms our feelings and our heart. Is the first person we talk to when we're having a bad day our Facebook page, a family member, a friend, or is the first person we talk to when we're having a bad time our Lord and Savior Jesus? You know, this past week I was mowing my grass, and oh, I'm so dumb. I was mowing my grass, right? So I'm pushing it. And I get back towards the shed, and for those of you who've been at the parsonage, you know I'm talking about the shed. Well, in the back, it's just always water. So there's these boards that are lining up to the shed, so I don't have to walk through the water all the time. Well, I'm mowing, and I think to myself, I have to move these boards in order to mow under those boards. I have to move these boards so that I can, anyway, that doesn't matter. So I'm pushing, and I'm going around the boards, and I'm like, I have to move this. Well, I turn my foot, and my toe, I'm wearing shoes, but my toe hits the board. That was crazy. Hits the board perfectly. I don't know how this happened. Again, I was wearing shoes. But the board basically split my nail and my skin. Right? And so at this point, I'm like trying to pull it off. Well, it got stuck on my shoe. So I'm like trying to move around. Julie's not home. Nobody's home. It's just me. I'm mowing, and I'm trying to get this board off. I finally fling my foot back. And I'm good. Now, my toe's obviously red and bloody and stuff, but that's another story. All the kids in the room are like, oh! That's what happens when you grow up. You hurt yourself a lot, just like you do now. It's just worse. But what happened is this. When I immediately kicked that board, this is true. This is what I do. And some people think I'm crazy. I kicked that board, and I immediately would go, Lord Jesus, please help me. And I immediately begin praying. And I finally get that board off. And then that pain begins to, you know, it's no longer in shock and you're in pain. I'm walking around. I'm like, Lord Jesus, please. Please, I don't want a broken nail. Listen, I've had like 10 ingrown toenail surgeries. I'm like, God, I don't want another ingrown toenail. God, I pray that you would just please do amazing things for my toe right now. I'm walking around going, Jesus, please. Jesus, please. Because that's my first initial response. But I know we're not all like that. And listen, that's not always my response. Praise God, in that moment it was. But my response should always be that. But what does your response look like? Thank you, Jeff. What does your response sound like? If somebody were to walk by in that very moment, whoo, somebody's witness is whoo, that's gone. And see, we have to be careful. But see, in those moments, that's where our daily walk with God is going to be shown. If you are constantly in communication with God, your response in that moment is most likely going to be, God, please help me. But if you are not in constant communication, which we're going to talk about here in a minute, if you are not in constant communication with Him, if you talk more with other people, if you are on your phone more than you talk with God, if you're on social media more than you talk with God, then your immediate response is going to be to go to that person or that thing that you go to most often. Because when, like we talked about last week, when the weight of the world hits you, it's what you go to most often that you will go to in those moments. What are you standing on this morning? Are you hoping that your friends are going to be able to bring comfort? Are you hoping that your friends are going to be able to give you the right word? Or do you have the faith and knowledge and understanding that God is going to be the one who provides for you? And sometimes it will be through a friend. But you need to go to God first. None of that was written down. So we're going after 12 today, I'm sorry. Kids, I'll go fast though. Don't worry. You will eat lunch today. Luke 11:5. By the way, for those of you who don't know, also, this our projector on Easter Sunday, the bulb died. And so this is not the projector that's going to be here. This is the kids' projector. That's why it doesn't fit on the platform, on the screen, really, and that's why it just looks weird. Next week, it should be all fixed. It'll look good. Actually, it'll look really good. It'll look really good. You'll be able to read the words, actually, probably, because the bulb is a lot brighter. Amazing, right? Amazing. But anyway, so back to the scripture. You're not going to be anything on the screen today, but if you want my notes, you can ask me after the service, okay? And I'll get them to you this week. Luke 11:5, it says, "And he said to them," this is Jesus, "which of you who has a friend will go to him at midnight and say to him, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves, for a friend of mine has arrived on a journey, and I have nothing to set before him.' And he will answer from within, 'Do not bother me, the door is now shut, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, though, he will not get up and give anything because he is his friend, yet because of his impotence, he will rise and give him whatever he needs. And I will tell you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it will be opened." Now, many of you have probably heard that passage. Ask, seek, knock. Ask and you will receive. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. But that parable before is very important when referring to that passage of Scripture. So Jesus here, he's talking about, you have to put it in the context again. You have to put it in the context of what these people are hearing. They're hearing about somebody showing up at a house at midnight. Now, first of all, that's still crazy, all right? People didn't show up at people's houses at midnight back then just like they don't do now, right? All right. I mean, unless somebody's showing up at your house at midnight, then sorry. Like, hi, that's crazy. But for me, that doesn't happen. So it's dark, right? They don't have lights that they can turn on. They're either lighting a lantern or doing something along those lines. Well, these people, when this person shows up at this house and asks for bread, there's a couple of things that you need to know. Jewish custom said that you had to have something for your guests that showed up. So when this guy knocks the door and says, "Hey, I need bread because a friend of mine showed up at midnight and I need bread for them and I don't have any bread," he's not saying, "Hey, I want to impress this person." He's saying, "Hey, I need to fit the norm." Like, this is, "Hey, I don't have a couch in my house for this person to sit on. Like, can I borrow a chair?" Like, that's what we're talking about. This is how ingrained it is to the Jewish people that they understand, "Hey, yeah, you need bread for this person because that's the right thing to do." But it's not just that. When we think about this house, this is not a modern American home. This isn't a two-story. This isn't a ranch with 3 bedrooms, 4 bedrooms. Parents are in one room. Kids are all in the other room. No, this person shows up at this house and says, hey, I need bread. And the father of the house, probably got kids, probably got animals in the house. He's like, thinking to himself, I'm going to wake up everybody. Like, if I'm going to get you bread, I'm going to disturb everything that's going on. And so we have to understand that, because when Jesus gives us this parable and he says, hey, if a man came to me at midnight, Jesus is saying to you, if you came to me at midnight and asked for bread, ask and you will receive, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened. See, it doesn't matter the circumstances that you're in. God wants you to come to him. He understands your needs. He understands where you're at, and he wants you to come to him. Don't quit in your prayers, but continue to bring your needs and requests before God. Stay in close relationship with him. He will provide for your request, or he will change your heart to be in line with his if you stay close to him. Sometimes you shouldn't get what you're praying for. And in the moment, you don't understand that, because your heart and your mind is set on this one thing and you think, God, this is the only way that it's going to work. But our God is a lot smarter than you. Praise God for that. And so when we pray, one of two things is going to happen. He's going to say yes, or he's going to say no. And if he says no, if you continue to pray through that, you will see God begin to change your heart and begin to change your mind to fall in line with his will. And you will be at peace when you pray through. You know, my son Caleb, you're doing so well, buddy. I'm so proud of you. This is what it looks like. I'm a dad, so sometimes I'm sitting down. This is not when I come home. Sometimes I'm just sitting. You're sitting down. You're hanging out. And Caleb will come up to me and say, Daddy, I want juice. I'm like, all right, buddy. Well, I'm in the middle of something. Like, I'll get you juice in here in a minute. 30 seconds, not even 30 seconds, 10 seconds later. Daddy, I want juice. I'm like, all right, bud. Like, I get it. Daddy, I want juice. And he will continue to ask me and ask me and ask me until one of two things happens. He realizes he doesn't actually need juice. He's just bored. Or two, Daddy finally gets up and gets him juice. And so when we pray, one of two things is going to happen. Either Daddy is going to get up and do what you need him to do, or you're going to understand you're not praying for the right things in your life. And so we have to begin to pray and pray and pray and then wait and wait and wait on God to move and speak, because he does. We don't pray to a dead God. We don't pray to a God who doesn't understand. He understands where you are. He hears you, and he is alive. The first thing I want you to understand today is that we need to be persistent in our prayers. Now, some of you are like, but I've heard the scripture where it says don't babble on like the pagans. Well, yeah, all right, here we go. In Matthew chapter 6, verses 7 and 8, Jesus says, and when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they will think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. So when you hear this passage of Scripture, he's talking to the pagans of the day. And the pagans of the day basically would do certain things where they would, it's crazy, they basically made God a puzzle that they had to solve and figure out. So when they would pray certain phrases over and over again. They would be like, Father God, blah, 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 blah. They had a puzzle that they had to solve. It was a code. And if they could break the code to God, then God would move on their behalf. But Jesus isn't a puzzle you need to solve. He's not a code that you need to pray to. No, Jesus is alive and well and living and seated at the throne of God. And be persistent in your prayers. And this is what it says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16. It says, let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. You don't have to pray a code. You have to pray in faith. You have to pray with confidence that God hears you. How often do you pray with confidence that God hears you? Or are you just praying because it's something you feel like you need to do? Are you praying to the God who holds the universe and holds you? Are you praying to the God who died on a cross, rose again on the third day, and is seated at the right hand of the Father in heaven? Or do you pray to the God of your mind because you're just praying? Are you confident that he hears you? He does. He does. I love this. Luke 18, verses 1 through 8. It says, "And he told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, 'Give me justice against my adversary.' For a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, 'Though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming.' And the Lord said, 'Hear what the unrighteous judge says, and will not God give justice to his elect who cry to him all day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, he will find faith on earth.'" Jesus isn't being compared here to an unrighteous judge. No, 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 no. See, Jesus is that much better than the unrighteous judge. He's giving a parable and he says, listen, if an evil man will give in to a need that somebody has, how much more will your heavenly Father who cares for you, who loves you, who wants to hear you and act on your behalf? Continue to pray and you will see God move, or you will see your heart change. If you're walking around with bitterness towards God, it's probably because you're not in relationship with God. If you're walking around waiting on God to move and you're not seeing any change, it's probably because you're not in relationship with him. Listen, I've prayed for things for a very long time. My wife, Julie, is the first girl I ever dated. And we didn't start dating till I was 21 years old. If you're a teenager in this room, you probably want a boyfriend or girlfriend at this point. I was the same way. I remember being 14 and being like, I want a girlfriend. I'm just tired of being so lonely. But God had placed in my heart that I didn't want just anyone, right? I didn't just want a date. I wanted to find the one that I was going to spend the rest of my life with. And so for me, when it came down to dating a girl, it was going to be, am I actually going to be able to spend my life with this person or am I not? Now, I'm not saying that you're just going to date one person. That's how it worked out for me, all right? But that's not how it's going to work with everybody. But you should not be in a relationship with somebody that is going to push you further away from God. You shouldn't even pursue that. And so for me, I had girls who liked me who weren't in relationship with God. And so it was, no. But when I finally, I went years and years and years before God finally gave me what I asked for, right? Years and years and years. And there are people in this room who are like, Pastor Jonathan, you're 27 years old and I've been praying for decades. You laugh, but there are some of you in this room, and I am so proud of you to not stop. Because if God has not changed your heart yet, then he wants you to continue to pray. Some of you are waiting for family members to come to know Jesus. Some of you are waiting, and you've been waiting. Keep praying. Keep praying. Be persistent. Going back to Hebrews 4:16, be confident when you pray. Psalm 145:18 says, "The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth." There are passages of Scripture that talk about the importance of being clean and pure when we pray. If you are worried if God hears your prayers, my encouragement to you is look at yourself. Like, look at your life. Is Jesus, is he the meditation of your heart? You know, is he the one that when you wake up in the morning, you come to him? Have you repented of your sins? If you're in love with Jesus, If you want him to hear you, he hears you. I mean, that's really what it comes down to. You know, if you're worried about sin, repent of your sin. Repent of your sin, and he'll hear you. By the way, repent is a turn. It's not words. By the way, that's something you need to understand. Repentance is not a prayer. Repentance is an action. It's not a, hey, I'm not gonna do this anymore, and then the next day go, I did it again. No. Repentance is, I'm not gonna do it anymore, and I'm gonna take these actions to make sure I don't go back to that. Repentance is a direct 180. It's a redirection, not just of your mouth, but of your life. Whew. If you're being challenged today, this is the word of God. Take it up with him. Prayer is a blessing in our life. It is a blessing to be in relationship with God. It is a blessing that we can be in constant communication with him. People haven't always had that. Old Testament, they didn't have, some of them had it, but they didn't all have it. But we have that because of Jesus. I love this. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 says, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. And if you continue to read on in verse 47, it says, and the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. You know, so far last week we talked about Scripture. And, you know, when he talks about the apostles' teaching, that's what they're talking about. They're talking about the Word of God. They made the Word of God an important part of their lives. And so when they said they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, they devoted themselves to the Word of God, to fellowship. That's what we're doing here. That's what we're doing at men's group, at women's groups, at small groups. To the breaking of bread, that's when we eat together, you know. And that's not just eating together at church, that's eating together with fellow believers, talking about your life, and to prayer. If we want to see this church grow, if we want to see the kingdom of God grow, why don't we just follow what the New Testament Christians did? Why don't we begin to devote ourselves back to the things that Jesus taught were important? You know, the ultimate question that comes down to, we hear a lot. Worship team, you guys can come up. If you could just play quietly for a little bit here. One of the questions, you know, as pastors you hear sometimes is, I don't know how to pray. How do I pray? And the best way to do that is to look at Jesus. And Jesus says in Matthew 6, 9, 13, this is the message, by the way, so this is a translation of the, he says, our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. Set the world right. Do what's best as above, so below. Keep us alive with 3 square meals. Keep us forgiven with you and forgiving others. Keep us safe from ourselves and the devil. You're in charge. You can do anything you want. You're ablaze in beauty. Amen, amen, amen. So that's the way the Message translation. Or, you know, this is the Jonathan version. God, make yourself known to me. I pray that you would make things right here. I pray that you would sell my house. Do what is best for heaven and here. Provide for my needs and forgive me of all my sins. Help me to forgive those who have done wrong to me. Protect me from the devil and the bad things I wish to do. I give you my entire life and I will do what you want. You truly are an amazing God. Amen. God is not a puzzle we need to solve. We get to be in relationship with him, and he wants to be in relationship with you. He sent his son to die so that he could be in a relationship with you. Listen, your prayers might not sound great at first, but you're gonna, your communication with God will change over time. For those of you who are married, the first time, or even ever been in a relationship, first time you met your spouse, first time you met somebody of significance in your life, you probably were a little intimidated. First time I met Julie, I said maybe 5 words. And I'm telling you, she left the situation, literally. She needed antifreeze for her car, and I had a Jeep Grand Cherokee 2001, and I always needed coolant, right? So I always had it in my car, and somebody said, hey, you gotta call Jonathan. So I show up. She calls me, she's like, hey, where do you want me? I'm like, just park here. I come out, and I'm like, hey, can you pop the hood? She's like, yeah. She pops the hood. I'm like, boom, 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 fill it up. All right, you're good. I'll see you later. That was the first real conversation I ever had with Julie. I was nervous. I can't tell you how often we talk now, right? It's all the time. If you've ever talked with Julie, she doesn't stop. And if you ever talk with me, I don't stop. Your first prayer isn't going to be long because you're going to be intimidated. But if you continue to pursue God, if you continue to pray, if you continue to seek His word, your relationship and your communication will change and you will change. It might start with a 10-minute prayer, It might start with a 10-word prayer this morning, and a year from now, you'll be praying for 30 minutes at a time because that relationship has grown into that. 1 Thessalonians 5:16 through 18. If you have a soap card, this is your memory verse for the week. Rejoice always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. I'm trying to do this. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. Oh, I did it. That's your memory verse for the week. If you're wondering how to come to God, that verse helps you. Rejoice always. Come to God with thanks. If you don't have a soap card, they're over on the table over here, by the way. Come to God with thanks. Come to God rejoicing for what He's done. Why don't your first prayer be, God, thank you. Thank you for dying on the cross. Thank you for setting me free from my sin, for paying the price so that I can be in relationship with you. Amen.